The following program was made possible by financial support from the Arizona Heart Institute and Foundation. On February 8, 1997, many of our state's most distinguished dignitaries gathered at the Camelback Inn to celebrate and honor the lives of six incredible Arizonans. The honorees were named 1997 Arizona History Makers by the Historical League of the Arizona Historical Society. History makers who have enriched our state with their passion, devotion, and contributions to Arizona. Please join us for Arizona History Makers Gala 4.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to History Makers Gala 4 in recognition program. To announce the grand entrance of tonight's History Makers, please give a warm welcome to our Master of Ceremonies, Mr. Grady Gammage, Jr.
Good evening. I could get used to that fanfare stuff. That was kind of cool. It is my great pleasure to be your Master of Ceremonies for the evening, as I have been a couple of times in the past. If we can get you all to take your seats as quickly as possible, we'd like to introduce this evening's History Makers to you. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Roy Drachman, accompanied by his wife, Sally. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Bennie Montague Gonzales, accompanied by his wife, Diane. Ladies and gentlemen, Dell and Jewell Lewis. Ladies and gentlemen, Mrs. Edwin C. Holly Rosenbaum, accompanied by her great-nephew, Mr. Edwin Stickney. And ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Morrison Warren, accompanied by Ms. Paula Gray. It is my great pleasure to be your MC for this evening once again. I ask the Historical League to let me do this for a number of reasons. One is I really like history. And another is that I have discovered it is far easier to stand when wearing a cummerbund than to sit when wearing a cummerbund. This is an unusual occasion. It is an occasion on which we celebrate the coincidence of two holidays, Valentine's Day and Arizona's statehood birthday. I've always found that to be an interesting juxtaposition, those two holidays together. We celebrate love and we celebrate Arizona. And for those of you who are here this evening, we celebrate your love of Arizona through the people we honor here tonight. For the fourth time, under the sponsorship of the Arizona Historical Society and the Historical League, we're here celebrating those two occasions by recognizing individuals for their love of this remarkable place that we all share and live. We meet to do this every 2 years now is the cycle. You may have remembered when we started, we did it 1 year and then the next year, but then we have since been on a two-year cycle. So I think it is always worth very briefly pausing and recollecting on some of the things that happened in those 2 years. Despite an election during that two-year period, we have the same president we had. Despite not having an election, we have the same governor we had. We have weathered holding the Super Bowl, losing the Rose Bowl, and trading Charles Barkley. I have often at this event commented on the people who come to this event and what kind of a crowd it is. And I would note this evening that we again have the real estate development community with us, for we are still in a boom time for Arizona and the Valley of the Sun. Indeed, Del Webb has an entire table over here, and I'm sitting there. I told Jack I would plug Del Webb because he gave me a place to sit. We have built nearly 60,000 houses in Maricopa County in that two-year period. We have consumed the desert, the Arizona Republic tells us, at the rate of an acre an hour. It was a two-year period in which tragic bombs exploded across the United States. Arizona's forests burned. The stock market soared. Dial moved. Finova didn't yet. America West is still flying solo. We all learned that Sumitomo was not a large wrestling match between men wearing diapers. They concluded in Tucson that the Central Arizona Project was a plot by people in Phoenix to poison Pima County. This is a little aside, I'm president of the CAP, and every once in a while I kind of wish that were true. Steve Forbes won the Arizona primary and quickly disappeared from national electoral politics. Charlie Keating was released during that two-year period. We as a state voted in favor of marijuana, but we didn't inhale. The Colorado River was artificially flooded. School district funding was plunged first into chaos and then into that occasional synonym for chaos, the Arizona legislature. JFK Jr. got married. OJ got acquitted and then found liable. Lisa Marie and Michael broke up. My kids got old enough that I can come to things like this without getting a babysitter. Yes. Karen is here tonight. She wasn't here the last time because of that. Corporate downsizing gripped America. The carnal bunt fungus gripped Arizona. The federal government was shut down. The Grand Canyon was closed, but the Arizona Historical Society Museum in Papago Park at Marley Center opened. Two years ago, I stood here and reported to you, as I had been told to do by John Dialing for Dollars Driggs, that he would raise the money and would get that museum opened. Now, I reported that to you as forcefully as I could, but not without some trepidation, because there had been a difficult history about getting the museum opened. But John did it. He raised $3.4 million in pledges from corporations, individuals, and from the cities in Maricopa County based on a population proportion formula he worked out, kind of like MAG, I think. I'm not real clear on that. And the museum, as you know, is now open with the History Makers Gallery, six other exhibits, and five in the works. We now are going to move into honoring the individual history makers and presenting to them their individual awards. We are here to recognize six outstanding individuals for their contributions to our state.
Rising from the exquisite desert terrain nestled in a valley anchored by dazzling mountain vistas lies an Arizona city that has thrived and flourished over the last century. Emerging from a small western town into one of the nation's most envied communities, the progress and growth of Tucson, Arizona almost directly coincides with the genesis and evolution of the city's favorite son. The two have grown up and prospered together, partners in a glorious adventure that started in 1906.
My name is Roy P. Drachman. I was born and raised in Tucson. I've lived there for over 90 years. I remember when Arizona became a state in 1912, my father got his six-shooter out and went outside and fired six shots in the air, as a lot of other people did. I could hear the shooting going on as they were celebrating the date that Tucson, that Arizona became a part of the state of the United States. He brought the first motion picture machine to the state of Arizona, and he was an early pioneer in having movie theaters.
A witness to the birth of our state and son of an early Arizona businessman, but Roy was more than just a casual bystander. At a young age, he began guiding Tucson's maturation.
I was just a public citizen. I was just in business, working in the theater business, and I was active in quite a few organizations, and so I was elected to the board of directors of the Sunshine Club, and Well, the Tucson Sunshine Climate Club was organized in 1923 by a group of business people, businessmen, who felt that Tucson should promote tourism and health center.
Tucson was becoming renowned around the country for its healthy, dry climate, and Roy, as manager of the Sunshine Club, was driving the campaign. These efforts soon established the community as a tourist destination. Serving his community and even his country during the war was Roy's calling during these early years. But in the 1940s, Roy decided it was time to also establish himself and find a challenging trade.
I was just scrambling around, making a living from day to day and doing all right. I had a good job always and got paid well, but I always wanted to go in business for myself. And I don't know, I just thought the real estate business was one that it interested me for a long time. And when I first went in the Sunshine Climate Club, I met a lot of people and got acquainted with a lot of people, and I worked with a lot of real estate people because people would come in, they'd want to buy a house or rent a house, and I was in touch with them. So I knew a lot of them, and I saw how they operated, and I thought, well, I can do that. And so when the chance came, I went in the brokerage business in 1946 after I got out of the service.
As Roy's real estate business prospered, he didn't neglect his hometown.
Well, I've always felt that Tucson was a good place for people to live and work, and I also realize that you've got to have jobs, and you have to have jobs that pay well if you're going to have a healthy economic community. And so I've always been interested in economic development.
Early on, Roy established an alliance with acclaimed developer Del Webb. The two partnered in building Tucson's first master-planned community and later pioneered the shopping center concept in Arizona. One of their projects, the Christown Mall in Phoenix, was a design well before its time.
It was the first enclosed mall west of the Rockies, and it had about 600,000 square feet in it, which was a large center in those days. And it was different, it was unique in some ways. People came from all over the country to see it, see how we did it.
Another of Roy's early challenges was to sell the Hughes Corporation on building a large aerospace plant in Tucson.
That afternoon, they were going to look at Tucson, Phoenix, Albuquerque, and El Paso as potential sites for a new plant. So I spent 10 days with him. I never slept at home in those next 10 days. I was on the road working with the Hughes people, and we finally got them to agree to come here.
And the Arizona Department of Tourism has thanked Roy many times over for his next conquest.
One of the things that I did very soon thereafter was get involved with my friend Bill Beck, who was a baseball. He owned the Cleveland Indians, and he owned the Chicago White Sox. But he and I got acquainted, and I used to tell him in the winter time when it was 75 degrees here and snowing in the east and raining in Florida, I'd say, isn't this better weather than Florida has for spring training? And he kept agreeing with me. And finally, when he bought the Cleveland Indians, I kept bugging him, and he said to me one day, he called up, he said, we're going over to Phoenix on Sunday, and we're going to see Horace Stoneham, who owned the New York Giants. And he said, if he'll bring the Giants to Phoenix, I'll bring the Cleveland Indians to Tucson to train. So we went up on Sunday and spoke to Horace Stoneham, spent the afternoon with him, and we came back, and we started then getting the ballpark in shape, and they announced they were coming. That was the beginning of spring training in Arizona.
Roy also launched the Conquistadors, a group that energized the Tucson Open Golf Tournament, now a $1 million purse stop on the PGA Tournament. Roy was also an original partner of the Ramada Inn Hotels, unique at the time for being the first national chain of motor lodges. But for all his business mastery and achievements in bringing about economic growth to Tucson, Roy's legacy will perhaps best be measured by the philanthropic gifts he's contributed to his hometown.
This is my town. I born and raised here. My family lives here. My grandson, my grandchildren, my great-grandchildren live here. And you know, a lot of us have worked hard to try to improve Tucson. We have better medical facilities, better recreational facilities. We have a lot of things that are better. We have better schools and a lot of things that are better here in Tucson than they were. And I don't know, it's just a bug that you get bitten by and you just work for it.
Roy chaired the campaign to raise funds that established the Tucson Medical Center, the state's only medical school located at the University of Arizona. And he has made abundant contributions to the college to keep it a leader in heart disease and cancer research. One of his namesakes, the Drachman Institute at the U of A, is considered the model for studying and designing healthy, environmental-minded planning for communities. And the tireless native son continues to carry the torch for his hometown.
Well, why retire? I couldn't figure out why I should retire, and I think people live longer and happier lives if they keep busy, and I'm glad that I'm able to.
90 years ago, a small village and one of its children set out on a journey of enrichment, a voyage that years later can only be judged as an inspiring triumph.
Well, I don't know what my legacy will be. I hope it's that he was a guy who cared about Tucson and that he did what he could during his lifetime to make it a bigger and better place to live. And if I can leave that kind of a legacy, I would be happy.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand and welcome Arizona history maker, honoree, Roy P. Drachman.
Ladies and gentlemen, Roy's award will be presented to him this evening by his longtime friend and Ford Motor Company executive, Wayne Dornan.
Thank you. It's a great pleasure for me to recognize truly one of Arizona's great ambassadors, Mr. Tucson in every respect. Somebody said to me, how do you know he's Mr. Tucson? Well, you get off on Drachman Boulevard, you go by Drachman Park, they play baseball at Drachman Stadium. And I said, if you couldn't figure that out, go to Drachman Institute and they'll educate you. A man whose influence to bring baseball and golf to Tucson has just been described. He's one of the few people who has dedicated himself to the industry that he loved, the real estate and development business. The only man that I know that was president of the Urban Land Institute, the International Council of Shopping Centers, and the Realty Counselors. The only person that I know in this entire profession. He's truly dedicated, very generous to the university. I once watched the basketball coach come into the stands and describe to Roy that he was going to play Sean Elliott only a half and then some other Kerr or somebody. And I said to somebody next to me, why do they ask Roy about this? And the guy said, if you gave that much money, they'd ask you. A humble and wonderful man, Roy Drachman.
Well, we're very sorry.
Thank you. This is a great honor, and I appreciate the award very, very much. I'm particularly glad to join Barry and Bob Goldwater as history makers, because about 150 years ago, his grandfather and my grandfather left Poland, a small village in Poland, to come to America. They came together and they ended up in Arizona, and it's a pleasure to be joined with them in this wonderful organization, and thank you very, very much.
It starts with barren land. The soil stimulates, enlivens the mind of a master. On the vacant page, a genius creates. It must be more than just walls, rooms, and a roof. More than a building, an office. More than just grass and trees. It's a place to learn, reside, inspire. It must graciously coexist with its environment, complement the landscape, and respect and embellish its surroundings. It is a skill that requires imagination and craftsmanship. The artist is the architect, and Arizona is the birthplace and home of one of America's premier artist architects.
I'm Bennie Gonzales. I'm an Arizona architect. My uncle was S.L. Cahill. He was a local contractor in Phoenix, and he was very close with my father. They were both partners in a little construction company, and my uncle's sons were in the construction company, and it was a wonderful place for me to start off with. My dad died when I was 7, and my uncle took me under his wing and took me to his construction jobs along with my cousins, and I became very closely allied to the construction trade.
At age 8, Bennie was put to work on one of Arizona's landmark structures.
The thing that took my interest was these fellows were making little wood forms, and they were the forms that Frank Lloyd Wright had designed for the block that's on the face of the Biltmore. And so one of the fellows took me over there where they were pouring concrete into the forms, and he says, here. They opened up one of the forms, and he says, now take and cover these little cracks with a little spatula. And so I feel very close to the Biltmore from that standpoint, of course.
A stint in the Coast Guard during World War II provided an opportunity for Bennie to study architecture around the world.
The architecture, of course, was a very natural thing for me to go to these cities, you know, in Europe and in San Francisco, New York, and all of those areas. And I was very interested in it. Of course, I had a good fundamental knowledge of building and the aesthetics of architecture started to grow on me. And when I came back to Phoenix, I decided to go to school at ASU.
After graduating from the ASU architectural program, Bennie decided to continue his studies south of the border in a land where the ancient architecture had long fascinated him.
When I thought perhaps I should do some postgraduate work at the university, and I went to Mexico, and of course it was a revelation for me because the Mexican architect was a lot looser than the American architect, who was bound by all of the building codes, etc. And the architect in Mexico was considered more of an artist than a builder type of a person. Going to Mexico and visiting those pyramids, and all the way from Cancun to Tulum and the other areas, and I saw the wonderful masonry that they could do, these what we felt were uneducated people 1,000 years before we came along, and doing this fantastic building.
Bennie garnered the wisdom of these early masters and went on to study under many of Arizona's prominent architects of the era. Shortly after, he landed a solo project that was very close to his heart.
Well, the Nogales Library, of course, was my mother's birthplace, and when I was asked to do the library, I had done a couple of houses in Nogales, and one of the owners of one of the houses I did was on the library board, and he asked me if I wouldn't want to do the library, and so it was quite a credit to me to be allowed to do something like that.
After the privilege of crafting a landmark in his mother's birthplace, Bennie procured another project with family ties.
Well, my uncle, with his contractor partner, built the original Heard House. So it was a great honor for me when the Heard Museum Board asked me to do the additions, because nothing had been done to it at the time, and they wanted to keep it in its original context. And of course, it was a natural for me, you know, having worked with the people and knew what it was about. So it was a great adventure for me to be able to work on something that my uncle and cousins had worked on.
An innovative style was beginning to emerge. With respect to his acquired Mexican and Southwestern influences, Bennie was developing a unique contemporary flavor to his designs. The architectural world was taking note, and bigger ventures would soon come his way. One being the glorious Scottsdale Civic Center, perhaps the most magnificent and enchanting municipal hub in the country. In the early 80s, after attaining an unequal status in his field, Bennie became disenchanted with the continuous battles with building inspectors and decided to take his career and life in a new direction.
And I said, I'm going to do my own thing now. I took my Mercedes and traded it in for a pickup and took my suits and ties and traded them in for Levi's and T-shirts and left and came to Mazatlan, went to Mazatlan, where I really was a free spirit for years, actually. And
after designing a number of beachfront hotels to pay the bills, Bennie headed back to Nogales and built his dream home, where he sculpts, paints, and occasionally takes on a project of his liking. Although his career in architecture has voluntarily slowed down, Bennie is the first to tell you he is far from retired.
I think, hey, I'm 72 now. I'm getting there. And then I think of two of my biggest heroes. One was Picasso, and the other one was Frank Lloyd Wright for his independence. And they were both 92. They died at that age, and they were still working at that age. And I hope that, you know, for some stroke of luck, that I'll be around for 92, and I'll be wondering what I'm going to do in the next 20 years. I think that that's the big opportunity.
But for now, Arizona can be thankful for the contributions Bennie has made in his first 72 years. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Arizona history maker, Bennie Gonzales.
Bennie's award will be presented to him this evening by one of his best-known tenants, Sam Campana, the mayor of Scottsdale.
Thank you. Bennie, we have you back in a tuxedo tonight. That's wonderful. And it's a great and rare privilege to be able to introduce you to Bennie Gonzales. I hadn't been mayor for 2 weeks that Bennie, at my invitation, didn't come in and share with the city manager and I some of the wonderful stories about the building of Scottsdale City Hall. And we're getting it back to some of the original form, too. I promised you I would do that, Bennie, and we're hard at work at it. I want to read you this because I gave it some thought and I want it to be just right. Bennie, your innovative designs have helped give the state its very architectural character. Each day we enjoy your handiwork in buildings that are distinguished by basic forms and dimensions, uncomplicated functionalism, and ageless simplicity. Over the years, you have continued to be an architectural visionary, realizing long ago that Arizona would experience phenomenal growth and the need to preserve our cities as vistas of beauty. He designed, as you saw, the Scottsdale Civic Center in 1965, and 10 years later, he added the Scottsdale Center for the Arts. Since Scottsdale is the proud recipient of several of your architectural wonders, Bennie, including the world-renowned Civic Center, the Center for the Arts, the Scottsdale Conference Center, and the Boulders Rock Resort, it's only fitting that we have this opportunity to present this award on behalf of the Historical League of the Arizona Historical Society. While your architectural genius is recognized throughout the world and your concepts and designs have been illustrated and celebrated from coast to coast, as well as in Europe and the Orient, we in Arizona like to claim you for our very own and hope that this award will convey our heartfelt thanks and appreciation. Congratulations, Bennie.
Thank you very much. Of course, you all know that it takes a wonderful client to make a good building. And aside from that, in my early training, Dean Elmore, Mr. Elmore, who's here tonight, was the fellow that taught me in the first classes at ASU. I was one of the first to graduate from the School of Architecture at that time. And I'd like to have Mr. Jim Elmore stand up. I owe so much to him. Thank you.
Thank you, Bennie.
Technical, just rip this.
Your speech in the end of my...
The perky beauty broom.
Rolling on what I'm...
Television. During its inception, designed to serve the public's interest. Today, television most often serves to pad a large conglomerate's pocketbook. In an era where terms like hostile takeover are more frequently used than community service to describe this field, one Arizona broadcasting partnership has survived and prospered. It's a merger of a different kind. A story of politics, farming, compassion, family, and most of all, love.
My name is Dale Lewis.
I'm Jewell Lewis.
To understand how this unassuming couple became media entrepreneurs, we must go back to a small town in the 1930s. And no, not Hollywood, but Florence, Arizona.
I had a Girl Scout leader, and I would go to her house to take, you know, our meetings for Girl Scouts, and she had a son in there that we used to kick out of the room. His name was Delbert. And so anyway, she also had a daughter named Louise, and she and I became very good friends. But we were tormented by her brother all the time. He didn't like girls, and we couldn't stand boys, so.
I had no interest in women whatever. Matter of fact, I thought they were just terrible. And they were always in my hair, and I always had fights with my sister, and with I was just a boy. And the boys were boys, and the girls were girls.
The makings of a beautiful and lasting relationship. Before the courtship could sustain further irreparable damage, Jewell's father, Superior Court Judge Ernest McFarland, was elected to the United States Senate, a venture that would take Jewell far away from Florence to our nation's capital.
There I got to witness some of the most wonderful things that happened in history and some of the worst things. Like, for instance, I got to sit in the family gallery when Franklin Delano Roosevelt made his infamy speech for the Second World War. My mother had said, "Oh, she's got a history test today." And my father said, "This is history in the making."
While Jewell observed the historical war from Washington, D.C., Dell witnessed it firsthand serving in the Navy. In 1946, he returned to Florence, where a chance encounter occurred soon after.
I was back in Florence, and at the time, we were at a Mexican food restaurant. And so he happened to come in, and it was Louise I recognized. I didn't recognize him at all, and he didn't recognize me until Louise told him who I was.
And then I said, "Oh, yes, I remember you." And I didn't, but she looked a lot different then than she did from the time I had seen her before.
But there would be yet another hitch in their courtship. Jewell had been accepted to numerous prestigious all-girls universities on the East Coast. Dell's plan was to attend the U of A.
So she asked her doctor in Florence to tell her father and mother that she had this bad cough and this drier climate would be better for her health. And she really should stay out in Arizona.
Jewell tells the story a little different.
Guys, my goodness, you could have a different date every single night because there were the ratio between the veterans and the girls were so great that Dell started dating my roommate. And boy, I did find out about that, and I kept quizzing her, and then I'd say, oh, you really don't want to go with him. And so all the while, then finally, Dell called me back up and asked me out, and then we went several times together, and then we sort of fell in love.
But there would be one last hurdle to overcome.
So we were planning on getting married in 1950.
And my father said, oh, no, not until she gets her master's degree.
And so she spent the next year at George Washington University getting her master's degree. And then we had a big wedding in 1951 in Washington. My father-in-law asked Jewell and me if you would like to go back to Florence and operate his personal cotton farm in Florence. He said, I'll let you run my farm and help you get started.
The newlyweds returned home to begin the first in a long line of successful business ventures together. Back in D.C., Senator McFarland was continuing to make important and historical contributions in the Senate, including his authorship of the GI Bill. And he also sat on the Communications Subcommittee, where he became a strong voice for the entertainment industry.
He was very supportive of the Hollywood community and their battle with the Red Herring Chase and Un-American Activities Committee that they had in the 40s. So he established a little reputation, but he always liked communications and the film industry, and so he was more or less their champion in those days.
That was when he decided that he would spend some time on seeing how we could get a television station. And so some of his contacts told him all about how to do it, and so we all formed a group to buy the television station.
So we opened on March 1st of 1955 and had a big grand opening and went on the air with ABC Television.
Channel 3, KTVK, was born. And Dell and Jewell found themselves on the board of directors for this new burgeoning venture. But television was not an immediate success.
It was an expensive deal. You know, when you're live, there you can't go back and correct your mistakes. And I don't know exactly about the other stations, but I know we had a tough time from 55 till 61 with money. We were behind all the time. It was when we had 40 or 50 employees. And many times our cotton farm had to support the station. And I had to run up to Phoenix to help get some money and get a draw to meet the payroll.
Technological advancements in television reception and videotape machines led to more viewers and advertisers. But ABC's lackluster programming in the early years kept Channel 3 from competing on a level playing field with their Phoenix counterparts.
We struggled with them. Mr. Goldenson did start that network off with on a shoestring, and he was always called the stepchild, and the third-rate ABC station was always third-rate until one day in 1976, I think it was, he hit it big with Roots. And he had Laverne and Shirley, and some of those real popular sitcoms came on. And all of a sudden, he won the whole national book in 1976, and ABC ratings shot to the top. And then everybody wanted ABC.
During this period, Senator McFarland would become Governor McFarland. Jewell was a mother of five and a school teacher, and Dell was shuffling his time between his farming and broadcasting enterprises.
Even all during the 70s, I was on almost a daily basis, driving from Florence and Coolidge, do my farm work in the morning, clean up, and then take off for the station in my pickup truck and get to Phoenix about 10 or 10:30, until I wouldn't go back home until about 6:30 or 7. So it was a long day for me. And driving, too, I don't know how I survived that, but I got lots of tickets, speeding tickets to prove it.
But when my father was ill, then that took him out, and we had to, Dell had to be there then all 5 days, which he has done ever since.
The failing health and eventual passing of the family patriarch thrust Dell to the helm of the station. And with ABC's newfound success to build upon, the Lewis family set out to make Channel 3 number one.
Well, we wanted to really upgrade. We figured that the best thing to do was to get a real successful station, a news operation, be number one. So in 1980, we started hiring and upgrading staff.
And we have the finest team now of any place. And even ABC said, well, if you want to know how to do business, go out and look at Channel 3.
But in the new corporate world, being the best isn't always enough. In the television business, money is king. So after years of surviving with inferior network programming and building the number one station in Phoenix, ABC pulled the plug on Channel 3 for the almighty buck. In a complex series of acquisitions, all started by Australian media magnate Rupert Murdoch, Phoenix television affiliates began changing hands, leaving KTVK without network programming.
When the axe finally fell on us, it was such a shock to us because we were being held up by ABC as a shining example of how to run a news station, what a great operation we had.
And then when ABC left us, we had all of our programming to buy. And anyone who isn't in the business does not have any idea how much that programming costs. So we were in debt right away.
We thought, since we had such a good position in Phoenix market, in our market here, that we would make the transition and try to maintain the same position we had in news dominance and programming. And to do that, we had to spend a lot of money. We had to buy all this good programming. We had good programming, but now we have to program for 24 hours. So we increased our news up to 7.5 hours a day, signed on with CNN. We already had Oprah, but we got Jeopardy and Wheel of Fortune. So we went ahead, Jack, just like we were a network.
We have worked long and hard. All of our staff have just been unbelievably great in how they've gotten in there and worked. I was just reading some numbers last night, and for all day, we beat all of the networks. So we're holding our own.
The perseverance paid off and allowed the Lewis family to expand their media business. Their company, Mac America Communications, now operates two additional TV stations, including a 24-hour news channel, two radio stations, Phoenix Magazine, and a film and video production facility. And all five of their children have followed their parents into the business. But perhaps Dell and Jewell's greatest legacy has been supporting charitable efforts throughout Arizona.
Well, we want to give back everything that the community has given to us. We want to give back.
And so all those things make you feel that it's just self-pride that you can pay back for the fact that you were living here all your life and finally had something to return to the state through your success.
Success and love, established over 50 years ago in the small town of Florence. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for Arizona's number one team, Arizona History Maker honorees, Dell and Jewell Lewis.
Okay, relax again, relax again. Dell and Jewell's award will be presented by a voice you've been hearing all evening and a past Arizona History Maker, Pat McMahon.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, we've been having dinner together tonight. You didn't know that that we were going to be doing this official ceremony part together. And I'm sure that probably if you'd had the opportunity that you might have picked someone with a far more prestigious reputation than I.
Never.
For those of you who are saying we've had quite enough of McMahon narrating the tape and doing the presentation, I will be passing among you with after-dinner cordials shortly after this presentation. There are actually two or three reasons why it is that I was chosen. One, I have a great deal of experience at making presentations. I was the one who actually awarded the crown of Miss Guacamole of Toltec several years ago. The aluminum siding award from the Home Depot people. I do these things in my career, and it's because of that kind of class and quality that I was chosen to do this. And second reason is because I'm the only one in the building who has not worked for you. And since you recently bought Denmark and a number of other acquisitions, I was the one who was chosen to do this. Yours is the only station that I haven't worked for. And from what I understand, this was your idea.
Never.
And the third reason is because I have had my day filled wonderfully, splendidly with Dell and Jewel Lewis, because I got here just in time. I have black tie scars today because I changed tuxes in the car from having done three shows at the Orpheum Theater today at a grand public opening of a theater, of an edifice, of a monument, of an entertainment location that is only possible because of the remarkable generosity of these people. I come from theater people myself, and I stood on that stage knowing that my parents had worked there in vaudeville, knowing that I had been there with Wallace and Ladmo, and knowing that it lives again because of you, and that this community is so much better because you're a part of it and because you're our neighbors. So I thank you so very much. I appreciate everything that you've done for all of us, and God bless you. I sure am glad that you decided to move back here from that Eastern school. Ladies and gentlemen, Dell and Jewel Lewis.
Thank you. Okay. I can. You know, we're very deeply touched by this honor. We learned the importance and value of community service a long time ago from Mac. My father, Ernest McFarland, who loved this state and this country and served both with great dedication. Tonight, it's a privilege and an honor to receive this distinction and accept this reward. We have been blessed with a wonderful family, both our children and our family of employees, all of whom care a great deal about community support and involvement. We live in a terrific state with boundless opportunities for service. Thank you again for this very special honor.
There wasn't too much said about broadcasting in the video, so I might refresh people's memory about the days of real early broadcasting. My friend Boyd Orth, who's sitting right here at my table, and I were probably some real pioneers in broadcasting. Boyd got for Christmas a crystal set. Quite a few of you remember what they were. This was when radio was practically non-existent. I think KTAR and KOY were just barely on the air then. And he was toying around with crystal sets. So we had an interest in radio back then. And, of course, I've had many hats on since the opportunity to go into broadcasting, one of them being farming. And I was a graduate engineer. I did that for 3 years. And now I've got 44 years of cotton crops, consecutive cotton crops behind me, and 40-some years of television business. But I wanted to say one thing about Pat McMahon. It's not his fault, but he told me this story, and I don't think he said it tonight. When he first came to Phoenix looking for a job or checking out the country in the Southwest, he came to our station first. He talked to Bill Adow, our station manager at that particular time, and we had no place for him, so we lost Pat at an early age, and I've been sorry for it, Pat. I've learned something tonight listening to the other recipients so far, and it's been an idea of my father, late father, my late father-in-law, and most of the people whom I know. Don't retire. Roy said it, Denny said it, and I say it, so just keep on working as long as you can, and that's the best thing for long life and happy life, and so I believe in that theory. Thanks again for the History Makers for this occasion.
Thanks, Tom.
This is the story of a love affair. A love affair of a different kind that began when a young Colorado school teacher made a pilgrimage to her adopted home. A partnership that has remained steadfast and faithful for over 75 years. The companions in this love affair? A woman, alias Peppery Polly, and her beau? A place, aptly nicknamed the Grand Canyon State.
I'm Polly Rosenbaum. I'm a native of Iowa. I grew up in Colorado. I came to Arizona to teach. I got a job down in Arizona in a mining camp that paid more money than I could possibly make up in Colorado where I was living. So I came on the train. I thought it was the hottest place I had ever heard of. And the smoke was belching out of the smokestacks at Hayden. And the only thing I could think of was Dante's Inferno.
Love at first sight. While teaching school in Hayden, Polly met her one and only true love of the humankind, Bill Rosie Rosenbaum.
He was working in the mill when I knew him, but he was a pharmacist by profession. He got into politics through the American Legion. He was a hard worker, and he'd worked hard in the American Legion. And some of the fellows came over from Globe one day and said to him, "Rosie, why don't you run for the legislature?" "Oh," he said, "I don't know too much about politics."
Rosie was eventually persuaded and began a distinguished 20-year career as an Arizona legislator.
He was a majority floor leader for years. He, of course, was very much interested in the working man. He was interested in what was good for Arizona, particularly in health problems, being a pharmacist. He was never one to brag about his accomplishments much. But he was a very dynamic figure in Arizona history.
While Rosie was off in Phoenix, Polly remained an educator in Hayden until the mine closed down and she was relieved of her teaching duties. Her shorthand experience landed Polly a job as a stenographer for the Arizona Appropriations Committee.
I went home, packed my bags, and came to Phoenix on Monday morning. And I never worked harder in my life. I had studied politics and legislative work in school, but it's nothing like the real thing. I got here. I came out at 8 that morning, and there was another woman working. So we took verbatim notes of the actions that went on in the committee that day, stayed at night and transcribed them. So we got through and had them on the men's desks the next morning.
This in the days before transcription machines and word processors. Upon her arrival in Phoenix, Polly renewed her acquaintance with Rosie, and wedding bells soon followed. The newlyweds settled into the Adams Hotel, home of Arizona's other rural legislators. It would be at the Adams where Polly would receive a first-hand education on Arizona politics.
It was quite a place. They all say that's where the laws were made. They weren't really made there, but I'll tell you, they were discussed there. The third floor was usually taken over by the legislature, and we had the same room. The wives came with the husbands in those days, and I usually stayed because I always brought a typewriter, and I was there to write up memos and do things if they needed.
Polly took more than just a passing interest in lawmaking, frequently presenting Rosie with the female perspective of certain issues.
If he was very busy, I would read the newspapers and clip what I knew he should read. And we always discussed the things. Oftentimes, we would argue, I mean in a nice tone of argument. And I'd say, "But listen, you ought to hear the woman's viewpoint on that. There is a difference, you know." And he often said, "Yes, I had never thought of that angle."
In 1949, Polly's mentor and soulmate, Rosie, passed away unexpectedly after they returned home to the Adams following just the second day of that legislative session. Suddenly widowed and uncertain what the future held for her, Polly would be thrust into a new career and lifestyle.
In those days, they appointed the wife quite often. The Board of Supervisors in the county you were from would appoint a person to take their place. And I had worked with Rosie so much and so long, and they wanted to know if I wanted the appointment, and I said, "Yes, I do." So that was the way that I was appointed. He was buried on a Wednesday, I came out the next Monday morning and sat in his chair in this building here and carried on from there.
Still mourning her loss, Polly decided the best way to honor Rosie's memory would be to complete his unfinished business. But she suddenly found herself a woman in a man's world. To fulfill one of Rosie's missions, a law introducing a traffic code for Arizona, Polly was provided with a challenging opportunity to assert herself and demonstrate that she belonged.
One man came to me and he said, and he came over and he said, now I'll take the traffic code and handle it for you. And I said, no, I'm perfectly able of doing it. And he really got very upset. And I wouldn't give it up. And words ensued. And I can remember backing up against the wall. And he said, well, why won't you let me have it? And in those days, I wasn't as smart as I am now. And I blurted out, because nobody trusts you. Your word's no good. Well, if I had been a man, he would have knocked me down. And I remember in this room in here, of backing up against the wall, and a gentleman from Yavapai County said to me, I'm staying with the lady. I will go along with what she wishes. Then another one from Santa Cruz County spoke up and he said, I will too. Well, I had won the battle.
The first of many battles Polly would win during her 45-year career in the House of Representatives. Polly served the vast and diversified District 4 and its constituency of everything from ranchers and farmers to mine workers. She championed the health care needs of her rural citizens. Crusades, Polly was able to observe the effects of firsthand.
And I remember being up in Sholo one day, and somebody came up and he said, oh, I want to meet you. You saved my life. And I said, if you don't know me, how could I have saved your life? And he said, well, I know, because you were one that voted for the dialysis machine, which it goes to the different rural parts of the state. And I thought after it, how little we know sometimes what we're voting about, to know the far-reaching effects of it.
Polly was also an impassioned education advocate, a trait she attributes to her days as a schoolteacher.
Libraries, to me, are one of the most important things ever. The library is a place where you can go no matter how poor you are, how little you have, and there's a wealth of material, and books are there. And I said, if I never did anything else, I'd like to see every child in the state of Arizona have access to a free public library. And we build prisons instead of libraries. Once a school teacher, always a school teacher.
Polly also proposed an idea that served two purposes for Arizona. She initiated the University Student Page Program, which provided college students with first-hand legislative experience and supplied the state with highly motivated, low-salaried employees. This economic and educational practice is still utilized today. Her penchant for guarding state funds and fighting the abuses of taxpayers' money led to Polly being given a memorable nickname.
Yes, Virgil wrote the story and called me Peppery Polly because I was chairman of administration and I was really clamping down on money being spent for things we didn't need. So I don't know where the Peppery came from, but it came.
In 1994, after 45 years of legislative accomplishments and serving longer than any of her female counterparts, Polly took on another historical assignment, preserving the rich heritage of our state. She now dedicates her time to protecting celebrated Arizona landmarks and establishing historical museums in literature. And at 97 years old, what are Polly's plans for the future?
Well, I think work. And there's a joy in accomplishing something. When you accomplish something, I think you really feel that you've contributed something for further generations. And I like accomplishing things.
And no one has accomplished more for the state of Arizona than the incomparable and ageless First Lady of the Arizona Legislature. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the protector of the heritage of our state, history maker honoree, Polly Rosenbaum.
Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats again. Holly's History Maker Award will be presented by her dear friend and former Arizona legislator, Betty Rock.
Thank you for all coming this evening. Earlier this evening, I ran into Keith Turley, and I said, Keith, thank you so much for coming this evening. And he said, Betty, I've heard so many people trying to reinvent our history that I had to come tonight to find out what history is all about in Arizona. I have known Polly ever since all the legislators stayed at the Adams Hotel in the 40s during their legislative sessions. And years later, when I was elected to the legislature, Polly was my mentor. We served on appropriations, education, and judiciary committees together, and we were allies on many legislative issues. I remember Polly being stickler on passing quality legislation rather than quantity. Polly, over the years, you have been held in such high esteem by everyone who knows you, and she has been at the forefront of carrying through so many major state projects that she is truly the first legislator of the Arizona legislature. She was in 1982 when she was given that honor, and she still is today, and nobody will ever surpass her. And Polly, to someone I have greatly admired over the years, it is a very special and distinct honor to present to you in recognition of your many years of valued contributions to our state, the Arizona History Makers Award of 1997. And put that out.
Well, I thank you very much. And Betty, it isn't often I get surprised. I can usually anticipate, but you surprised me tonight. I want to tell you how much I have enjoyed serving the people of Arizona. I've loved every minute of it, bad times and good times. I was fortunate enough to serve when we had a coalition in the House. Democrats and Republicans were in the majority. Democrats and Republicans were in the minority. It was just a case of philosophy. We've accomplished much. I think back and think of the community college system, the water legislation, and too many other things to mention. I am delighted to become an Arizona history maker, and I promise you I will continue diligently to preserve the history of Arizona, my adopted state, and where I've been happy. Thank you.
Thank you.
An old man traveling a lone highway came at evening, cold and gray, to a chasm that was vast, deep, and wide. He crossed the chasm in the twilight dim. The chasm held no fears for him, but he paused when he reached the other side and built a bridge to span the tide. Old man, said a fellow traveler near, why waste your time in building here? Your journey will end with the close of day. You never again will pass this way. You've crossed the chasm deep and wide. Why build this bridge at eventide? The builder lifted his old gray head. My friend, in the path I've come, there followeth after me today an eager youth who must pass this way. The chasm that held no fears for me, to the eager youth may a pitfall be. He too must cross in the twilight dim. My friend, I build this bridge for him.
The Bridge Builder, the inspirational doctrine that one distinguished Arizona educator lives by.
My name is Morrison F. Warren. I was born in Marlin, Texas. I've lived in Arizona for 71 years. I was raised in the neighborhood of 12th Street in Adams, which was just a few blocks from downtown. And Van Buren actually was north. And in that neighborhood were Chinese grocers, white grocers, black and Hispanics. And it struck me very early that I had very good friends among all those ethnic groups. But we didn't attend the same schools. We would meet Friday afternoon, play all day Saturday, play after church on Sunday, and then we went to different schools. I never understood that. I laughed to keep from crying about it, but I never understood it really.
After being honored as valedictorian of his high school graduating class, Morrison went on to Phoenix College.
My high school class only had 17 students. 17 students. So I really didn't know how good I was as a student. I wanted to go to college very badly. But I didn't know. And this is one of the reasons that I'm an integrationist. I think it's only in the open, competitive marketplace that people really know and find and can evaluate their effectiveness. I went to Phoenix College as a 17-year-old student. And my freshman year, I took algebra classes, I took Spanish, and I took biology courses, zoology, the real tough courses, got straight A's.
At the height of World War II, Morrison volunteered to serve in the Air Force. A profound episode during this period set Morrison forth on what would become his life's work.
An officer and I went to visit Buchenwald concentration camp in Weimar. You just could not fathom that this was a possibility, and how could this happen, man's inhumanity to man. So I was very, very sensitive to that, and it had an enormous impact upon me. And in view of the fact that I was in the danger zone, and you, there's a 50-50 chance or less that one will not make it home, but I did make some promises to God that if I came home, I was going to spend the rest of my life building bridges between people. And I was going to spend an enormous amount of my energy with young children before they develop hate. One has to learn to hate.
Thankfully, Morrison made it back to Arizona. Determined to pursue his calling, he enrolled at Arizona State College in Tempe to procure a degree in elementary education. While playing for the ASC football squad, Morrison encountered yet another episode of intolerance that would shape his life.
We were scheduled to play the University of Texas at El Paso. The day before the game, the administration at ASU was informed that they should not bring the two black athletes because the local police and the school could not be responsible for control of persons in the stands. The Arizona State College said that they would never play a team unless all of their players can play and be treated like gentlemen and so forth.
Morrison began his teaching career at Dunbar Elementary, where he soon took on the role of halftime principal. During this period, he received his master's degree in school community relations. Shortly after, Morrison accepted the principal appointment at Booker T. Washington Elementary, where he promptly began initiating innovative educational programs for the students and the community.
And the first one of that was the fact that I think that parents play a very significant role in the life, in the educational life, as well as in the life of children. And they model for children. So time spent with parents may be more important than time spent with children, particularly if the school is trying to institutionalize some behaviors that need to be reinforced at home, then it means the persons at home then have to take on the role of teachers. And so I formed an organization called Foundations of Understanding and worked with parents to help them to understand to know and to understand, because I think commitment grows from knowledge and understanding.
In 1959, Morrison completed his doctorate in educational administration and supervision. Dr. Warren also championed many community causes, serving administrative roles in organizations such as Head Start and the Arizona Advisory Committee to the U.S. Civil Rights Commission. In 1966, Dr. Warren became a member of the Phoenix City Council and was appointed vice mayor in 1969, an era for prominent accomplishments of the council.
People who travel about cities in this country are fascinated how easy it is to get around in our city and how clean we are. We develop a master plan. Oh, one other thing we developed was a sensitivity to the poor. We developed, we call it LEAP, Leadership and Education for the Advancement of Phoenix at that time, but the sensitivity to humans in the city. I think that's our greatest contribution.
In 1968, Dr. Warren returned to ASU, accepting a faculty position in the School of Education. Using his decade-long experience as a hands-on instructor and administrator, Professor Warren established a prestigious reputation for his publications and lectures on cultural-related education topics. He served as director of the I.D. Payne Laboratory School, a research arm of the ASU School of Education, which dedicated itself to exploring and implementing effective multicultural public education. Dr. Warren's leadership experience led to him being sought out by several Arizona corporations and organizations to serve on their board of directors. And in 1981, he became president of the Fiesta Bowl board, becoming instrumental in securing the game as an all-important New Year's Day matchup. Just 4 years later, the Fiesta Bowl hosted the first of its storied history of national championship games. But for all of Dr. Warren's triumphs, the accomplishment he will most be praised for is the one he set out to fulfill on that infamous day while serving his country in World War II.
And I like to think that my work in the community has been one of building bridges between people, young and old, in and out, black and white, male, female, moneyed, non-moneyed, housed, non-housed, educated, uneducated. And it has been a beacon of my life. It's something I decided upon a long time ago, and I think my life validates it.
I would whisper love so loudly every heart could understand, that love and only love can join the tribes of man. I would give my heart's desire so that you might see the first step is to realize that it all begins with you and me.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand in tribute to Arizona history maker honoree, Dr. Morrison Warren.
I'll come back over here. I have to one moment of personal indulgence. Dr. Warren is allowed to call me Gigi. He's one of the few people I allow to do that. And in turn, I hope I am allowed to call him Dit. Dit's award tonight will be presented by the chairman of the board of Pinnacle West, Mr. Dick Snell.
Thank you, Grady. You will all remember him now and I think in the years ahead for his accomplishments in the fields of education, his commitment to education, his athletic prowess, the bridges that were referred to in this movie among the races, just altogether a wonderful man. I will remember him on a more personal basis for, what, 20 years that we spent together on the APS board when Dick talked about his children with great affection and pride, when we did a lot of fishing together, when we told some stories that ought not to be repeated tonight, and just altogether a wonderful experience. But I would have to tell you that from my own personal standpoint, what Dick brought to our board of directors and to me personally was a sense of the human being. When we talked about numbers and great plans and strategies and all that, Dick would always bring it back to what's in it for the employees, what's going to happen to them. I needed that then, and although since Dick retired a couple, 3 years ago, other people have been providing that. Nobody ever provided it better than Dr. Morrison F. Warren.
Thank you. Thank you.
And I've got somewhere around here.
Thank you so much.
I'm the last on the program. I suppose I can think of, take a few moments. I am so thankful for a number of reasons for receiving this great recognition tonight. First of all, my pastor's here, so I shall say I'm thankful to God, because I think he/she has a master plan for us. Secondly, I'm thankful to multiple people, because I'm a great believer that we're all victims of context, where we were born, to whom we were born, whom we come in contact with, who models for us at certain times. In fact, it's all said in the metaphor when we say, well, I was at the right place at the right time. Events, circumstances, supporters, people who challenge us, who make us think, etc., all play a hand in shaping us. And when I'm shaping us, at the bottom line is our view of the world and how we interpret events. I think we're all victims of it. And I think process is content for us to go through certain processes, and there are certain outcomes. So I say to the thousands of people whom I've come in contact with, whom I've taught, who challenged me, who supported me, etc., they too should share in this award. Thirdly, I'm thankful that four of my children are here and were able to witness, and we're criers. I saw my son next to me crying. And so I'm thankful they were here, and I'm also thankful that three of my grandchildren are here. My daughter and a grandson came from Toronto, Canada. His dad, John Shoemate, is an assistant basketball coach. But they wanted to come down and view this, and I'm very happy. I'm also thankful for the persons who nominated me and for the committee who made the final decision, persons who did the research on the various individuals and ran interference for me, who advocated for me. I thank them. I'm thankful to the persons who made the final decision. I'm very thankful to you. I'm also thankful to the wonderful people of the Historical Society, whom I've had the pleasure of this last year and working with. Most of the interviews you saw today was done following my coming from the hospital. I had both knees replaced on September the 26th, but it came out better than I thought, and it really, I think it was to the genius of the young men from the Arizona Heart Institute who did the job. Thank you very much.
That concludes our glimpse into the lives of six remarkable Arizona history makers. Thomas Carlyle said, history is the essence of innumerable biographies. We've heard six biographies this evening that distilled for us the essence of our wonderful state. Thank you for coming tonight. You have enriched our state with your accomplishments. You have illuminated our lives by your example, and you have honored all of us with your presence here this evening. Thank you very much for being here. Happy birthday, Arizona. Good evening.
Makers of history, makers of dreams, sharing a vision, sowing the seeds of a land filled with beauty, both desert and snow. We salute Arizona and the people who make her grow. In a world where no one listens and all the people wait for someone else to lead the way or leave the way to fade, who will stand and make a difference? Who will speak out loud and shelter that great silence with voices that are proud? Makers of history, makers of dreams, sharing a vision, sowing the seeds of a land filled with beauty, both desert and snow. We salute Arizona and the people who make her grow.
The preceding program was made possible by financial support from the Arizona Heart Institute and Foundation.